Morning children. In last class we have discussed about valence bond theory and its limitation, its application, everything we have discussed. Valence bond theory explains the bond between the central metal atom and the ligand. Okay, it explains very clearly, but it has some limitation. In last class we have discussed, okay, all the limitations. Now to overcome those limitations, now we are going to see another theory, that is crystal field theory. This theory explains the color of the complex, the magnetic behavior of the coordination complex, okay, etc. We are going to discuss in this part. Initially, this crystal field theory used to explain the bond between the ion, the bond between the ions. Okay, that is ionic bond. Only it explains about the, it is used to explain about the ionic bond. Okay, for ionic compounds only they use this theory, how the bond is formed, all those things. Okay, but later it is used to explain the properties of transition metal, that is D block elements. Okay, it is used to measure the properties of the D block elements and their complex formation character, all those things. Okay, it is used to explain these characteristics of the D block elements. Now we are going to see the salient features of this crystal field theory. Okay, here first I will tell 3 points. Okay, the first point here, in this central metal atom, in this according to this theory, the central metal atom and the ligands are considered as charge points. Okay, that means how in ionic compounds we used to say, no, cation and anion. Between this cation and anion, there is an electrostatic force. Okay, between them there is electrostatic force. That electrostatic force only is called as ionic bond, isn't it? Okay, the same only we are going to consider here between the ligand and the central metal atom. Okay, children.
Yes. Here the first point, the salient is called the crystal field theory. The first point here we are considering the central metal atom and the ligands as point charges.
Here you can guess who is a plus charge and who is a minus charge. Here the central metal atom is a plus, isn't it? Central metal ion Fe3 plus, Fe2 plus, CO3 plus, Cr3 plus, like that we are writing, isn't it? So it is a plus, and the ligands are coming with electrons, okay? Cl minus, F minus, Br minus, okay? So here the central metal atom is positive and the ligands are negative, okay? So if the central metal atom is a neutral atom and the ligands are neutral molecule, for example Fe, the oxygen state is 0 there, and the ligand is water or amine, okay, in such a case we can consider the central metal and the ligands as poles, okay, dipoles. One pole is having electron and another pole is having vacant place, okay, so dipole. Okay, children, so first point is the central metal atom and the ligands are considered as point charges or dipoles. In case of cation and anion, in case of charges, it is considered as point charges. In case of neutral central metal atom and the neutral ligand, just it is considered as poles, okay, dipoles, opposite poles, okay. That is the first point. Okay, the next point here, central metal atom, how it is forming bond with the ligand, okay, that's what we are going to see. Okay, the first point here is the bond between the central metal atom and the ligands are ionic. That is the first point, children. This is the second point. This is the point charges are dipoles. Okay. The third point, how the complex is forming between the central metal atom and the ligand. Okay, he is giving a new idea, new approach to this complex formation. Okay, valence bond theory also explains well, but here they are taking a new way. Okay, now we will see how it is. Okay, so first when we take one octahedral complex, here 3 steps are coming. In series of 3 steps, we are going to explain how the complex is formed here. First step, the central metal atom in a gaseous in gaseous state, the settlement level. Let's say here the d orbital. Okay, the d are all the five d orbitals. Okay, in gaseous state them an isolated atom. Okay, in all the five d orbitals are degenerate. Degenerate means it is having same energy. Let me write here in circle type. How will draw in box type? No, in the same way. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, the same box type only. Just I have written in circle type. Okay, because in Yapu they are using this type only. So let me use the same. Okay. Now all the 5d orbitals are in same energy. Okay, here this d orbitals are the d orbitals are having some orbitals are vacant. Okay, in the valence material also we have discussed, no, when the ligands are coming, it should have enough number of vacant orbitals, like that we have discussed, no. Okay, the same one we are going to see here. Okay, so all the 5d orbitals are present. When the ligand is coming, the ligand, actually the electrons, okay, with electron is coming, isn't it? Then this sentiment atom also will have electron with it. Okay, so that when the ligands are approaching the sentiment atom, both will start to ripple. Okay, because of the repulsion, the degenerate will be lost. Okay, so it will lose its energy. First of all, when the ligands are approaching, it goes to the excited state. The energy is increased, it goes to the excited state. After that, when the ligands are approaching further, the orbitals are splitted. Okay, now the energy is differing. Okay, now all these 5 orbitals are having not equal energy. Okay, they are differing. How they are differing? Now I will say. Okay, so here for octahedral complex. Let's say here x are x plus x minus x plus y minus y, same is the axis. Plus z and minus z. In this origin, let's say the sentiment atom is present. Okay, in this sentiment atom is present. The sentiment atom is having d orbital. We know the d orbital's names, isn't it? What it is? D xy, d yz, d zx, and this two d x squared minus y squared, and the last orbital is d z squared. Okay, so these are the names for the 5d orbitals. Do you remember? Okay, the shapes also we have learned, the clover leaf shape. Okay, d z square shape is double shape. D x squared y squared will come along the axis. Okay, x axis and y axis, it will come along the axis like this. D z squared, it also, it is a double shape, it will come along the z axis. This d x y, d y z, d z x, all these orbitals are like in between the axis, between x and y, between y and z. Okay, like that it will occupy. Only d x squared y, d x squared minus y squared, and d z squared, these are alone will lie along the axis. Okay, now the sentiment atom is present in the origin. Now the ligands are coming. Okay, now octahedral complex I said. Now 6 ligands are coming. When the 6 ligands are approaching at the 6 axis, okay, along the direction of this axis, okay. So when it is coming, it is approaching directly, okay, towards this axis. So the ligands, so the orbitals which lie along the axis will experience more repulsion. Okay, before I said, no, when the ligand approaches the sentimental atom, the sentimental atom also is having electron and the ligand also is having electron. So when they are coming closer, they will start to ripple. Okay, so same way here when the sentimental
six ligands are coming here, ligand 1, ligand 2, ligand 3, ligand 4, ligand 5, okay, ligand 6, okay, like that all the six ligands are coming and approaching along the axis, okay. So the D XYZ, X squared and XYZ, and D is Z squared, okay. These orbitals will have more energy because they face more repulsion. The remaining three orbitals which lies in between the axis will face less repulsion and it shows less energy. Okay, dxy, dyz and dzx. The energy difference between this two splitting, okay, now it is splitted into two ways. This three orbitals are called as T2G. Okay, T2G orbitals. These two orbitals which lie here is called as EG orbital. Okay, T2G, remember. Now here after we are going to use this word, okay. Instead of writing or instead of telling each time DXY, YZ and DZX, simply we can say T2G orbitals. Now T2G orbitals means these orbitals, okay. EG orbitals means these two orbitals, okay. That is dxy minus y square and dz square, okay. These orbitals are called as EG orbitals, okay. T2G orbitals and EG orbitals. So the energy difference here, O is nothing but here for octahedral complex. So the energy change in energy here is nothing but the difference between, okay, difference between this two orbitals, okay. Okay, here out of 5 it is only 3, okay, out of 5 it is it is plus 3/5, it is minus 2/5, okay, just remember that number. Plus 3/5 and minus 2/5 del naught. Okay, when you add these two, otherwise simply we can say when we subtract these two energies, okay, from here to here, we will get the del naught value for octahedral complex. What is the energy is present there? Okay, like that we can get it, children. So now when the ligands are approaching along the axis, now this orbital which is lying along the axis will face more energy, and which have less energy, which lies in between the axis will face less energy. Okay. The next step here, at this step also, this is second step. Okay, the first step is coming and second step is splitting. And third step, even at this time also the complex formation is not taking place. When the ligand approaches further, then only the complex formation will take place, okay. After splitting, in EG and TPG orbital also, the complex formation is not taking place, okay. When ligands are approaching further, then the negative part of the ligand and the positive sentimental atom will attract with each other. Then only it leads to the formation of complex formation, okay. So here for octahedral complex, they have given me a book. But when they are asking in a 5-mark question, you start to write from page number 153, from step 1. Okay, from that you have to start. Don't write only the 4 lines for 5 marks, okay. The heading may given there, crystal splitting in octahedral complex, like that, the heading may given there. But you have to write from the first step itself, okay. Because they have mentioned in above steps, like that they have mentioned. So you have to write from there, okay, children. Here, when the ligand approaches the sentimental atom, the energy will decrease. Okay, the energy which is decreased, that energy only is used as a driving force to form a complex. Okay, that energy only is used as a force or energy to form a complex there. Okay, there is no additional energy given there. Okay, children, that's all about this octahedral crystal fit theory. Okay, crystal splitting in an octahedral complex, like that they will ask. Okay, so I will say once again, just to listen. Here in crystal fit theory, it is considered as ion.
bond. The bond between the sentimental atom and the ligands are considered as ionic bond. Here, according to this concept, sentimental atom and the ligands are considered as point charges or dipoles. And third point, this explains the crystal field theory, explaining how the complex is formed. Okay, so here, according to this concept, in a gaseous state, in an isolated gaseous state, first the d orbital, the central metal d orbitals are having same energy. All the 5 orbitals are degenerate. That means they are having same energy. But when it's moving to the excited state, okay, when the ligands are coming towards it, okay, there is a repulsion between the electrons of central metal atom and the ligand. Okay, because of that, it will, so because of the repulsion, the energy will be raised. Okay, it will go to the excited state. Okay, that state also is called as average energy state. Okay, average energy of the d orbitals is in a spherical crystal field, like that they have mentioned. Okay, the average energy after the ligand approaching. Okay, the energy will be increased. This is average energy, but it is not stable. Okay, this energy is not stable. In order to maintain this energy stable, it is splintered in such a way. Okay, so how it is splintered? Each orbital separately and T2G orbital separately. Why it is separated? Because the ligands are approaching in the axis. Okay, towards the axis, along the axis it is approaching. So the central metal atom orbitals, okay, which is lying along the axis in d orbital, okay, which is lying along the axis, will face more repulsion, and which is lying in between the axis will face less repulsion. Okay, that's all. So each orbital face more repulsion and d2g orbital face less repulsion. Okay, so in order to maintain this average energy, here this energy is splintered like this. Okay, it is plus 3 by 5 del naught and minus 2 by 5 del naught. Okay, this del naught is nothing but, this O is nothing but for octahedral complex. Okay, just to go through this, it is very very easy only. Okay, in one 5 mark question, we can explain. Just try, just remember as a story, ligand is coming. So it is a repulsion is taking place. Okay, because of the repulsion, the ligands are approaching in the axis. Okay, so the orbitals which is present in the axis only is facing more repulsion. So it will occupy the top position. Okay, more energy. So the ligands which are, the orbitals which are present in between the axis will face less energy. Okay, so it will come down. So remember like this. This number alone, remember, don't write in different way. Okay, it is only 3 by 5, it is 2 by 5. Okay, children, remember that it is plus, this minus. Okay, the sum of this 2 energy, that is the difference between these 2 orbitals energy. Okay, this plus 3 by 5 del naught and minus 2 by 5 del naught. Okay, difference between them only is known as the overall energy del naught. Okay, more question we can ask. Okay, if they give the del naught value, easily you can find the overall octahedral crystal field splitting energy. Okay, this is one 5 mark question. Next we are going to see crystal field splitting in tetrahedral complex. Now same only, in octahedral complex, how the ligands are approaching in the direction, in the along the axis, same only we are going to see in the tetrahedral field also. Okay, now let's see it here. Now tetrahedral complex. In tetrahedral complex, let's say here tetrahedral should be back side. One more. Okay, in this tetrahedral shape, just if you draw the cube, okay, just draw roughly and see. Now, the ligands, okay, as we discussed for octahedral, same here also, this central metal atom is in gaseous state and all the d orbitals are in degenerate state. But when the ligand is approaching, then the repulsion is there. So because of the repulsion, the energy is increased, the average energy is created there. Okay, when the ligands are approaching further, then all the degeneracy will be disturbed. So it will be splitted into two parts, okay, EG and T2G. Okay, the same way, same one.
the four ligands are the tetrahedral. So four ligands are there. It is approaching the sentimental atom in algebraic corner of the cube. That means there is no ligand approaching the sentimental atom directly. Okay, so that sentimental atom orbitals are not disturbed. Okay, no ligands are approaching directly there. In octahedral, directly they approach the axis orbitals, which the orbitals which is present along the axis. Those orbitals are directly directly had a contact there. Okay, but here there is no d orbitals having direct contact with the ligands. Okay, it is not approaching the d orbitals directly. But even though some orbitals are okay, let's say here there is no axial orbitals are disturbed. Okay, same here also x axis, y axis, z axis are present, but there is no ligands are approaching along this direction of the axis. Okay, so it is approaching at the corner of this cube. So who is disturbed means, so the orbitals which is present in between the axis, in between x axis and y axis, in between the y axis and z axis, okay, those orbitals are facing quite high repulsion when you're comparing with the orbitals which is present along the axis. Okay, children. So here, same way, in d orbital, five orbitals are there. D x square, sorry, d xy, d yz, and d zx. D x square minus y square and d z square. Okay, these three orbitals are present in between the axis. These two orbitals are present along the axis. Okay, in tetrahedral complex, where the ligands are coming, there the ligands are coming in the alternate corners of the cube. Okay, that means it is not coming along the axis direction. Okay, it is not coming along the x axis or y axis or z axis. Okay, so this EG orbital will face less energy. Okay, it is coming in between them, so that this T2G orbital, which is present in between the axis, okay, all these orbitals are present in between the axis. Okay, so this T2G orbitals are facing quite high repulsion, so they will face more repulsion and they will have more energy. Okay, children. So in tetrahedral complex, how the splitting will take place? The crystal is splitting. Now five orbitals are present. The degenerate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All these five are having same energy because of the ligand electron, sentimental electron. They will face repulsion and they will go to the excited state, and there it will have a average energy. When the ligands are approaching further, it will be splitted into two. To maintain this average energy, splitted into two. Okay, here who is facing more repulsion, who is facing less repulsion? Here EG is facing less repulsion. Okay, because the ligands are approaching in between the axis. Okay, so here EG orbitals will face less repulsion and P2G orbitals will face more repulsion. Okay, dx square, y square, dz square will face less repulsion. Dxy, dyz, and dzx. These orbitals will face more repulsion. Okay. Then the energy between this. Okay, energy between this. Here we are representing the symbol del T. Okay, the crystal field splitting energy for tetrahedral complex. For del T, here it is this three box. And three box coming this, what it is actually? 2/5. Okay, you have to remember, okay, 2/5. When two box is coming, it is 3/5. Okay, remember like the children. Okay, so it is 3/5, there it is 2/5. Del T, here also it is del T. Okay, the overall energy, we have one more question, page number 155, del T value.
Okay, see there, del t is equal to 4 by 9 del naught. Okay, put one box for that. It is one mark question. Okay, in one mark they will give you the del naught value. Octahedral crystal field's energy is 1.33 something. They will give the energy. They will ask you to find the tetrahedral complex energy. Okay, crystal field splitting energy for tetrahedral complex. They will ask you to find. Okay, so del t is equal to 4 by 9 del naught. Okay, that means the energy difference, or the energy created in this tetrahedral field is lesser than the octahedral field. Okay, in one mark question like that also they can ask, because the orbitals because the ligands are not approaching the centripetal atom orbital directly. Okay, when they comparing with the octahedral field, the tetrahedral field are facing less repulsion only, so the energy also will be less. Okay, so let me write that relationship here. So del t is equal to 4 by 9 del naught. Okay, so del t will have less energy comparing with the del naught value. Okay children, so write this also. This is one 5 mark questions also we can expect. Okay, you have to draw the diagram, you have to write step by step. Okay, very very simple. Okay, just you have to remember which will have more energy, which will have less energy. Okay, where the ligand is coming, whether the ligand is coming along the axis or in between the axis. Okay, when you remember this 2 point, easily you can write this 5 marks. Okay, this is very very simple 5 mark crystal field theory or crystal field splitting in a complex. Okay, now octahedral complex and tetrahedral complex. Okay children, just make a notes. Next we are going to see some other factor which is responsible for this crystal field splitting energy. Okay, so crystal field splitting energy, we know it is the difference between the energy of two orbits. Okay, the two sets of d orbits, that is t2g orbits and eg orbits. Okay, the difference between these two sets of orbits only is called as crystal field splitting energy. Okay, but here they are telling not only this factor, and one more factor also affecting the crystal field splitting energy. So what is that factor? Means the ligand, the nature of the ligand. Okay, so if the ligand is a strong ligand, it may have quite high repulsion. If the ligand is a weaker ligand, the repulsion will be less, like that. Okay, so the nature of the ligand also can affect this crystal field splitting energy. Now we are going to see with the example. Okay children, now this is one 2 mark question. Okay, so here they have written as discussed above, like that it is there. Okay, so when you are writing in your test, don't write as discussed above. So there what you have to write now itself, right there, just write beginning like this. Okay, crystal field splitting and energy is the difference in energy between two sets of d orbitals. Okay, write like that, then only you can write. Okay, the magnitude of crystal field splitting energy not only depends on the ligand field as discussed above, but also depends on the nature of the ligand. Okay, then only it will come in full meaning. Okay, so without writing the first line, don't write. Okay, as discussed above, you won't get a mark. Okay, so you have to write what we have discussed above. The crystal field splitting energy is nothing but it is the difference between the energy of two sets of d orbitals. Okay, so write correctly. Crystal field splitting energy is the difference in energy between two sets of d orbitals. Have you written? Okay, write in book itself. Okay children, now we are going to see how the nature of the ligand is affecting the crystal field splitting energy. Okay, here we are taking titanium 3 complex. Here 3 types of ligands are coming. One is fluoride and bromide and water. Okay, 3 types of ligands are coming. Let me write the ligands here. Titanium, Br6, 16 minus, this is one complex, and another complex titanium F6 3 minus, and another one titanium H2O6 3 plus. Okay, so like that three complex they have given. Okay, so here it is explained by spectrum. Okay, spectrum data only, from that only we are going to write. So they will give you the values. Okay, the lambda value, the wavelength value they will give. Okay, so one way lambda, it is wave number mu. Okay, according to Planck's concept in 11th standard, so we have discussed. Okay, Planck's concept, E is equal to h mu. Day number in De Broglie's equation we have discussed there. According to Einstein, E is equal to mc squared. According to Planck's, E is equal to h mu. Okay, so your mu is equal to c by lambda. E is equal to h mu and mu is equal to c by lambda. Okay, so when you substitute here, you will get E is equal to h into c by lambda, and E is equal to hc 1 by lambda. It is very number. Okay, just we can write mu bar. Here in this crystal field theory, energy we are representing by the symbol del. Okay, so del is equal to hc mu bar. Okay, so now they have given the wavelength for three complexes. Okay, when bromine is coming, what is the wavelength? When fluorine is coming, what is the wavelength? When water is coming, what is the wavelength? Like that they have given. Okay, 12,500, 19,000, 20,000 respectively, like that they have given for each complexes. Okay, so first let us substitute and do for titanium. It is hexa, bromido, titanium 3 ion. Okay children, because this is the complexes, anionic complex, so titanium it will come. So hexa, bromido, titanium 3 ion. We have the end with the word ion. Okay, it is anionic complex. Okay, now the value here 12,500. Okay, so then this is equal to H C mu bar. H is nothing but Planck's constant, 6.626 into 10 power 0 minus 34, and C value 3 into 10 power 8, and the mu value is 12,500. Okay, 12,500 they have given in meter, so they have given in centimeter, so we have to convert it into meter, because C value also in meter only. Okay, 3 into 10 power 8. Okay, so when we are converting in centimeter into meter, here it will come 10 power 2. Okay, so just remember why the power is coming, that 10 power 2. Okay, when you simplify it, you will get 5 digit number. Okay, remember there. In first one, it is wrong in your book. Just make a correction there. So when you multiply all this, it is 8 plus 2, 10. So when you subtract it from here, you will get 10 power minus 24. When you multiply 6.626 into 3 into 12,500, you will get the value 248475. Okay children, just remember this 6 digits you must have. Okay, then only you will get the book answer. Okay, they have written only 248 alone, it is wrong. Just make a correction there. When you multiply it, it will come 248475 in 10 power 24 joules. Next here we are going to write this one in kilo joules. Okay, when you are writing in kilo joules, it will become 248475 into 10 power minus 21 kilo joule. In next step, when you write the point here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, that is 248475, just subtract 5, so you will get 10 power minus 16 kilo joule. Okay, now the book answer you will get. Okay children, have you made a correction there? Okay, so here we have to express this del value on the basis of mole. Okay, per mole how much it is. Okay, multiply, so we have to multiply by Avogadro's number. You know the Avogadro's number. What is Avogadro's number? 6.023 into 10 power 23. Okay. So when we multiply this delta U, 2.48475 into 10 power minus 16 by Avogadro number 6.023 into 10 power 23. Okay. When you multiply it, you will get 149.4 kilojoule per mole. Okay, the same way you have to work out it for fluorido complex and aqua complex. So already they have worked out in your book. The answers are also correct. I have checked. Okay. So in same way, when you apply the values, these values are same. Only this value alone will change there for different complex. When you work out, you will get the answer. For bromine complex, it is 149. Okay. For Br- complex. Then for fluorido complex, the answer is 227.7 kilojoule. For aqua complex, it is 239.7. Okay. For bromine complex, it is 149. For fluorido complex, 227. For water, for aqua complex, it is 239. Okay, so the energy, the del value is less. See here, the crystal splitting energy is differing. Okay, why it is differing? Because of the nature of the ligand present in it. Okay, how much wavelength it is having. Based on that, we are having different energies. Okay, so from this we can say, who is the stronger ligand here? Comparing with the bromido, fluorido and aqua, who is the stronger ligand here? Water is the stronger ligand, aqua is the stronger ligand, okay, because it is 239.7 kilojoules per mole. Okay, so when you write the order, H2O is the stronger ligand, then F minus, then Br minus. Okay, so like that, the scientist put their work and their research and found the order of the ligands, okay, which is strong, which is weak, like that. Okay, that series is called a spectrochemical series. Okay. In your book, page 156, it is there. Mark it as a 2-mark question. The order you must remember. Okay. So water. Okay. Right. The ligands which is present in the right hand side of the water are stronger ligand, and which is present left hand side are weaker ligand. Okay. So you must remember that one. Just read and write and see. Okay, children. Okay. Stronger ligand, weaker ligand. You must remember. That's all about this crystal field theory, children. Next class we are going to see how this crystal field stabilization energy is used to distribute the electrons in the 5d orbitals. Okay, next class we are going to see that. Okay, now just let me recall what we have learned today. First, we have learned about crystal field theory. Crystal field theory, originally it is used to explain the bond between the ionic compounds. Later, it is used to explain the properties of d block elements, that is transition elements, and their complex formation characters. Here, the salient features are the bond is pure, it is considered as ionic bond. The second point is the ligand and the central metal atoms are considered as point charges or dipoles. And third point, how the complex is formed. Okay, by series of three steps we have discussed how the complex is formed. Okay, in octahedral field the ligands are approaching the central metal atom along the axis, so the orbitals which is lying along the axis will face more energy, so more repulsion, more energy, so it will be splitted t2g orbital and eg orbital. Okay, the next case we have seen in tetrahedral field. In tetrahedral field the ligands are approaching in between the axes, so that the ligands, so the orbitals which is present in between the axes will face more repulsion, so T2G will have more energy and EG will have less energy. Okay, then when the ligands are coming further, they will form the, then there will be the attraction between the central metal atom, positive ion, and the electron rich ligand. Okay, so that they will form a bond in the sense here, the electrostatic force between the positive and the negative. Okay, children, so that's all about this crystal field theory. The next we have discussed this crystal field splitting energy may be affected by another factor also, that is nothing but the nature of the ligand.
Bigand. Okay, based on the nature of the Bigand also, the crystal field stabilization energy will be varied. Okay, for that we have discussed one problem here. Okay, from that they have derived one spectrochemical series. Okay, the ligands which is present right hand side to this water are stronger ligand, left hand sides are weaker ligand. Okay, so read the spectrochemical series, children.
Crystal field splitting, octahedral splitting, tetrahedral splitting. Transition metal chemistry is dominated by d electrons that can occupy 5d orbitals. The crystal field theory, or CFT, is an electrostatic model. Ligands are treated as point charges or dipoles. As the ligands approach the central metal ion, a negative electric field is created and the degeneracy of metal ion's d orbital is lost. For a free transition metal in the absence of any crystal field, the 5d orbitals are degenerate, which means they all have the same energy. In octahedral field, six ligands are coming towards the corners of an octahedron, causing the central metal or ion orbitals to have different energies. In an octahedral field, six ligands approach, two along z-axis, two along x-axis, and two along y-axis. What happens to the energy of the d electrons if negatively charged ligands are brought in towards the metal center to give an octahedral complex? Since the d electrons are themselves negatively charged, they would experience repulsion from ligands and their energies would be raised. The degree of repulsion depends on the orientation of the d orbitals. In an octahedral crystal field, we say that d orbitals have an octahedral energy splitting, and we denote this by a delta with subscript O. Three orbitals of lower energy are represented by T2 G set, and two orbitals of higher energy are represented by EG set. Complete the d orbital splitting in an octahedral field by dragging the respective orbitals as indicated. In tetrahedral field, four ligands are coming in at the corners of a tetrahedron, causing the central metal or ion orbitals to have different energies. In tetrahedral field, imagine four ligands are lying at alternating corners of a cube to form a tetrahedral geometry. These four ligands approach along opposite corners of a cube, forming a tetrahedral crystal field. dz square orbitals is lowered in energy as it lies in between the ligand and experiences less repulsion. dx square minus dy square orbital is lowered in energy as it lies in between the ligand and experiences less repulsion. dxy orbital is raised in energy as it points towards the ligand and experiences more repulsion. dxz orbital is raised in energy as it points towards the ligand and experiences more repulsion. dyz orbital is raised in energy as it points towards the ligand and experiences more repulsion. In a tetrahedral crystal field, we say that d orbitals have tetrahedral energy splitting, and we denote this by a delta with subscript T. Two orbitals of lower energy are represented by EG set and three orbitals of higher energy are represented by T2G set. Complete the d orbital splitting in a tetrahedral field by dragging the respective orbitals as indicated.
Okay, so just go through it, work out the problems, whatever the corrections I have told in this part, just to make it in your book and read and see. Okay, children, thank you.